Do fat and carbs differ in how much energy they yield?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Last question from Jeff says, I thought I remember you saying in one of your podcasts that fat burning doesn't yield as much energy output, ATP maybe, that glucose burning does, but I'm not sure about that. Could you clarify that for me? Also, if so, how does that comport with fat containing more calories per gram than glucose? Shouldn't fat yield more energy? First of all, you should never, ever, ever, ever think of metabolism through the perspective of calories per gram. You want to think from the perspective of ATP yield. I mean, you could think of the perspective as ATP yield per molecule if you're trying to say, I don't know why you would even look at it per molecule. What you really want to look at is like, you could look at ATP yield per calorie if you're trying to say that. You know, it's conceivable that you get a different level of ATP yield per calorie. But, you know, generally calories are going to be roughly equivalent in ATP yield. But, the calories per gram is so totally irrelevant because your body doesn't care about grams, you know? Like so for example, if you're looking at like burning the carbon dioxide produced between a carbohydrate and a fat, that's some byproduct of energy metabolism that differs, right? So the way you would want to look at that is really per ATP yield. Or you could look at it per calorie to be more general. But it would be silly to look at it per molecule because the molecules have different amounts of energy. And it would be silly to look at it per gram because your body doesn't calculate grams of anything. You know, if you put in fat, 9 grams of fat, your body doesn't know that it's burning 9 grams of fat. It knows that it's burning X amount of ATP yield of fat. And that's what it regulates things by. But fat burning doesn't yield, so you said, I thought I remember you saying in one of your podcasts that fat burning doesn't yield as much energy output, ATP maybe, than glucose burning does. I don't remember saying that. I don't remember saying that. I'm not sure what that refers to. But trying to think of what I might have said. Glucose can generate more, ATP in more diverse ways. So glucose can generate ATP in the cytosol through glycolysis, and fat can't. That's one thing. And then there's also lots of things you can do with glucose that you can't do with fat. So glucose can support the pentose phosphate pathway. Fat mostly can't. Glucose can support anaplerosis, which is providing citric acid cycle backbones in order to keep it running. Fat can't do that. So glucose can do more things to support energy metabolism that fat can't. And glucose can yield ATP in the cytosol. I'm not sure it's possible that in something in the past, I did do something about yielding. I don't know if I did anything on ATP yield per calorie. I might have said that, but I don't. Let me just see if there's a. Let me see, 1 second. So I just pulled up this paper. How does the ratio of ATP yield from the complete oxidation of palmitic acid to that of glucose compare to the relative energy contents of fat and carbohydrate? And so this seems to answer your the question as it should be stated. And this paper is from 1998. And it says, the authors of many recent popular textbooks of biochemistry quote values for the energy content of triacylglycerol and dry carbohydrate on a weight basis, as well as presenting calculations for the yield of ATP yield obtained when a molecule of glucose or palmitic acid is completely oxidized to CO2 and H2O. By extending these calculations and computing the yield of ATP in terms of the weight of glucose or palmitic acid oxidized to CO2 and H2O, it can be shown that the value for the ratio of the energy content of fat to that of carbohydrate is almost identical to the ratio of the yield of ATP per gram of palmitic acid oxidized compared with that of glucose. Therefore, the efficiency on a per gram basis by which energy is made available as ATP is comparable for both the oxidation of fat and carbohydrate, thus underscoring the fact that the catabolic pathways for both fat and carbohydrate ultimately use the same means of generating ATP, namely oxidative phosphorylation. So they said comparable. See if they have exact numbers. So, you know what? This paper is real short. Let's just read it. It's like two paragraphs. Following calculation makes use of the more recent figures of 2.5 molecules of ATP formed per molecule of mitochondrial NADH oxidized by the electron transport chain that is coupled to oxidative phosphorylation, and 1.5 molecules of ATP formed per molecule of enzyme-bound FADH2 oxidized by the same process. For the complete oxidation of glucose to carbon dioxide and water, either 30 or 32 molecules of ATP can be formed, depending on whether cytosolic NADH is oxidized via the glycerol phosphate shuttle or the malate aspartate shuttle, respectively. For the complete oxidation of palmitic acid, 106 molecules of ATP can be formed. If we average the ATP yield for glucose and use a value of 31 ATP molecules, then on a weight basis, we find that 0.17 molecules of ATP and 0.41 molecules of ATP are formed when 1 gram of glucose and 1 gram of palmitic acid are completely oxidized, respectively. So I hate people. I don't hate the people. I hate the use of the sentence where with respectively at the end. It just makes it harder to read. So what that means is we find that 0.17 molecules of ATP are formed when 1 gram of glucose is oxidized, and 0.41 molecules of ATP are formed when 1 gram of palmitic acid are completely oxidized. Thus, the ratio of the yield of ATP per gram of palmitic acid oxidized to that of glucose oxidized is 2.4. Thus, over twice as much chemical energy in the form of ATP is obtained per gram of palmitic acid that is completely oxidized to carbon dioxide and water compared with oxidizing glucose. If we make use of the values usually quoted for the energy content of fat, 37 kilojoules per gram dry weight, and carbohydrate, 16 kilojoules per gram dry weight. And of course, that's 9 and 4-ish calories per gram.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.